Wonderful, so wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know. How glorious, how beautiful you are. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. Powerful, so powerful, your glory fills the skies. Your mighty works displayed for all to see. The beauty of your majesty awakes my heart to sing. How marvelous, how wonderful you are. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul. Beautiful one, my soul must sing. You opened my eyes to your wonders anew. You captured my heart with this love. 'Cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. You opened my eyes to your wonders anew. You captured my heart with this love. 'Cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my so must sing.
Frisk people on a regular basis. As I was saying, it's a friendly church. Okay? That was totally my mistake. I'm sorry. So. Welcome to Twickenham. We're glad to have you here this morning. And if you're looking for a church home, we're always looking for new family members. There's a card on the back of the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and drop it in the collection plate later on if you're a guest. And if you have a prayer request, let us know what that is, and we'll be glad to spend some time praying about that. If it's private, we'll keep it private. If you want everybody to know about it, we'll get the whole church involved. So just thanks a lot for coming out today. A little program note about the service this morning. You know how sometimes when we finish a song or something and there's a period of silence and nothing is happening, and then somebody gets up and walks up from the back, and we think, ooh, somebody missed a cue, right? We're going to have a couple of those this morning, but nobody's missing a cue, all right? And this morning, what we're going to do is build in a couple of places in the service, once after the prayer for the bread, and once after a prayer for the cup during the Lord's Supper time, just to pause and be quiet and be still, because there's not many opportunities to do that in our culture, and there is something profoundly important about patience and waiting. And so we're just going to build a couple of those in this morning. We'll do one more at the end of the sermon where we just stop and try to be slow and still, okay? So those are coming up in just a little while. I want you to know about that so you weren't sitting around going, who's supposed to be doing what? In those moments this morning, nobody's supposed to be doing anything except focusing on the Lord and what he's speaking to you right now. But as Ecclesiastes says, there is a time for silence and there is a time for shouting. And this is one of those times for us to stand. And we're going to begin our service by making a joyful noise to the Lord, singing together. So let's praise the Lord in loud voices this morning. Glad you're here. Let's worship together.
Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise, and give him praise. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your voice is raised, your voice is raised. Give glory and honor and power unto him, Jesus, the name above all names. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise, and give him praise. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your voice is raised. Your voice is raised, give glory and honor and power unto him, Jesus, the name above all names, Jesus, the name above all names. Lord, I come to your awesome presence, from the shadows into your radiance, by the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Spirit blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory.
But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Let's offer thanks for the bread this morning.
Let's pray. Dear God, as we gather around the table this morning to take this bread, we want to praise you and thank you for your promise of a Savior that you faithfully kept. We want to thank you for Jesus giving up his life to give us a hope of heaven. We thank you for knowing us so well that you know we'd need this regular reminder of the promises that you've already kept. Help us to encourage one another to share this good news of a Savior with others so that they can come also and enjoy this communion with you, God. Help us to encourage one another just to stay faithful and be patient as we wait for all of your promises to be fulfilled. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, draw me, Lord.
Oh, draw me, Lord. Oh, draw me, Lord. And I'll run after
James 5, verses 7 through 8 says this: Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for a text like this that teaches us not just to wait, but to wait in the midst of injustice and suffering. And that reminds us that we can do so because we are a people who have hope and faith in the promises of our God. As we gather around this table, Lord, we remember those promises today. We remember the promise offered to Eve long ago in Genesis 3 that said one would come who would crush the head of Satan. And some 4,000 years later, your son hung on a tree and spilled his blood to wash us clean. We remember the promise of an open tomb. And then one Sunday morning, the man Jesus Christ laid death in his grave that we might have life. And we have hope in the promise that the Lamb of God is also the Lion of the tribe of Judah that is coming again one day. And it's because of these promises, God, and the God who has made them, that we trust and we wait for the coming of the day of the Lord. In Christ's name we pray it. Amen.
who are thirsty,
all who are weak, come to the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to deep,
and we sing,
come, Lord Jesus,
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 come.
Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As he cries out to thee,
and we sing,
come, Lord Jesus.
As we take our offering.
Oh, the Lord, our strength and song, highest praise to him belongs. Christ the Lord, our conquering King, your name we raise, your triumph sing. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, and by his name we overcome. Though the storms of hell pursue, in darkest night we worship you. You divide the raging sea, from death to life, you safely lead. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord.
His name we overcome. All the saints and angels bow. Hosts of heaven are crying out, glory, glory to the King. You reign for all eternity. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory. By his name we overcome. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. 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 Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, and by his name we overcome. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, and by his name we overcome.
Be seated.
Amen. Man, that's a good song. This past week I had the opportunity to speak at the National Urban Ministries Conference in Atlanta. And one of the things that I told them, these are folks that work in inner city ministries, okay? So they have a job. And one of the things I said was, I think what you do is really hard. And the truth is, anytime you work on the border between the kingdom of God and the kingdoms of this earth, it's going to be hard. I don't care where you are. You could be in Palm Beach and it's going to be difficult. But I think their stretch of the border between God's kingdom and the world's kingdom is particularly difficult. And it's not because there's more trauma or sin in the inner city than there is in the suburbs. There is just as much sin and trauma here as there. The two differences, I think, are that there are more people, typically, crammed into a smaller geographical area, and they tend to be more out loud with both their sin and their salvation. So I think what they do is, what inner city folks do is very difficult in terms of their ministry. And here's the thing, another thing that I said to them. I said that sometimes people like me make what you do harder. And when I said people like me, I meant that sometimes people like us, suburban churches, sometimes make it harder for inner city ministries and churches. We mean well, we want to go help, we want to do the right things, but a lot of the times, the things that we think are helpful are not necessarily all that helpful to them. And so what I said to them was, if we're down here helping you, and there's a better way for us to do it, look, you're here and we're not, you tell us and we'll listen. And they really welcome that message, because I think they need us and we need them, but we want to be sure that what we do is what they need. Tuesday, there is a conference in town called the C4 Conference. That stands for the Cornerstone Conference on Community Compassion. It's much easier just to go C4. And several of us are going to go to that conference. It's here in town. It's here in Huntsville all day on Tuesday. And it's about that very thing. How can we really help folks that are in crisis, that are struggling, that typically are going to live in inner city areas? How can we be helpful without hurting? And so a bunch of us are going to go to that. If you've worked in our Mercy ministry in the past and you'd like to be a part of that, come up, let me know, and we'd love to help arrange for you to go to that. It's Tuesday from around 8 a.m. to 3 or 4 p.m., I think is when it ends. But that I think that's going to be a really, really good thing for us to hear. So, and then I'll bring you greetings back from folks in Atlanta. They said, hey. So, y'all remember the Lucy show, right? A lot of you, even if you know, your kids, you've probably seen Lucy, right? The Lucy show. I think it was one of the most successful television situation comedies ever. And episode 39, I think, may have been one of the funniest. Let me set it up for you. We're going to see a clip here in just a second about that. In episode 39, Fred and Ricky are complaining about Ethel and Lucy, which is the plot of every Lucy show. But in this particular one, they're frustrated because Ethel and Lucy have been spending a lot of money, and Fred and Ricky think that they don't understand the value of a dollar and how hard it is to get them and what it means to work hard and earn. And so they switch roles, okay? And so Fred and Ricky stay home and do the things that Lucy and Ethel have been doing, and that's we'll do that one maybe on Mother's Day, okay? Because that's pretty funny. But Lucy and Ethel go to work in a chocolate factory, okay? You've seen this, all right? Watch this clip. This has something to teach us.
What are you doing up here? I thought you were downstairs boxing chocolates.
Oh, they kicked me out of there fast.
Why?
I kept pinching them to see what kind they were. This is the fourth department I've been in.
Oh, I didn't do so well either.
All right, girls. Now, this is your last chance. If one piece of candy gets past you and into the packing room unwrapped, you're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Oh, this is easier.
Yeah, we can handle this, okay?
See, you don't have to be dirty or ugly to be funny. That was great. For several weeks, we've been exploring a passage in Matthew's gospel, Matthew chapter 28, 19, and 20, where Jesus tells his immediate followers, his immediate disciples, to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And then he adds, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. We began by learning that being a disciple is not about perfection. It's about progress. God's very patient with our fits and starts, and he's forgiving of our failures. So I think a lot of people want to bail on this whole Christianity thing because they think they're not good enough. And the whole basis of the Christianity thing is you're not good enough. Okay, so Jesus does it, had to come and die for us, and our job is to make progress in becoming more like him. And then we talked about how being attracted to Jesus is not what discipleship is about at all. It's about recognizing his authority. Jesus doesn't want fans. He wants followers. A couple of weeks ago, we focused on the fact that discipleship is not a destination, it is a way of life. It's not a thing that you go off to a distant land to do. It's how you live where you are. And then we had that day where we had 18 babies on stage, all the little ones that were born in 2015. And we talked about how to raise up a new generation of disciples. And the key there was that if we want our children to grow up to be followers of Jesus, we don't focus first on their faith. We focus first on our faith. Parents, grandparents, older siblings, all of the adults in their lives. So here's the lesson for today. And I think this one could be particularly challenging for this church in this community. Being and making disciples is not rocket science. It's more like an art. And Lucy and Ethel and a little history, I think, can help us kind of get our minds wrapped around that. Before 1912, moving teams of workers in Henry Ford's 60-acre Highland Park plant assembled Ford automobiles. The frames of these cars would sit on sawhorses, and the assembly teams would move from one frame to the next, adding whatever component they were responsible for. And then parts runners would run their deliveries, try to time their deliveries so that when the assembly team was ready to install whatever part they were responsible for, that part would be there. And then let's say that they needed fenders. They were being delivered right at the moment when they needed them. So you had people, hundreds of people running all over the plant, crisscrossing each other, a lot of them holding big parts, looked like a swarm of ants. It took 17 hours initially for Ford to assemble one automobile, 17 hours. In 1912, Ford hired a guy named Clarence Avery, who was a specialist in a new field called scientific management. It was basically engineering. Avery suggested installing conveyor belts to move the parts where they needed to be, and that cut down on a whole lot of runners. By 1913, plant engineers set up an experiment using winches to pull the chassis themselves down the assembly line. So now the assembly team stood still, and the cars came to them. Instead of 17 hours, it took 6 hours to build a car. And within a year, after all the bugs were worked out, Ford could assemble a car in 90 minutes. By 1923, U.S. auto production passed 3.7 million units. The Ford Model T accounted for over 50% of all the vehicles in the country. And by 1924, half the cars in the world were Ford Model Ts. There's one going by just now. Henry Ford's moving assembly line method revolutionized not just the auto industry, but every industry that had to mass produce identical products. And it was one of the reasons that America was such a powerful ally or enemy during World War II. Ford's manufacturing revolution was a crowning achievement of science and management and engineering. Okay, that's what was going on in the early part of the 20th century in the United States. So it's not a coincidence that in the 1920s, churches also began drawing from these diverse disciplines to try and find ways to fulfill Jesus' command to go into all the world and make disciples. That's the very thing we've been talking about. They were trying to figure it out back then, and they adopted some of those same ideas. In March 1922, Fred Little became the first Church of Christ preacher to deliver a sermon over the radio. Rather than going with mass production, churches turned to mass media. A guy named A.M. Burton, who was a Nashville businessman, even bought a radio station and sponsored so many Church of Christ programs that the call letters of the station, WLAC, came to be known as We Love All Campbellites. So just a few people got that. We need to do a class on restoration history, okay? So for those of you, that was a little inside humor there. The Campbellites comes from the name of a man named Alexander Campbell in the early 1800s. He was very influential in starting our fellowship, Disciples of Christ, Churches of Christ, Christian Church. We all kind of come from that same way of thinking. And so for a long time, people disparagingly called us Campbellites, but we did a little ecclesiastical jujitsu and embraced it, and so we kind of began calling ourselves Campbellites. We haven't talked about that in a long time. That's why that just went like that. Okay. Let me make a note here. Never use that again. Okay. Anyway, by the 1930s, and it was working. It was actually working, using mass media and trying to adopt some of those kinds of scientific approaches was working, and churches began to build larger and larger facilities to accommodate larger and larger crowds. By the way, this is in the, you guys in the booth, just hang on a second because this is not in the notes. One of the most significant influences on the growth of churches, getting bigger, was Henry Ford and the automobile. Because when people got cars, they didn't have to walk to the neighborhood church or ride the wagon to the neighborhood church. They could get in a car and drive. And so churches moved out, bought land where it was cheaper, built bigger and bigger facilities, and people could drive to them. Tremendous impact it had on the church. It's just one example of the way you got to pay attention to your environment, every part of your environment. Anyway, by the 1950s, churches began to employ management-style techniques to organize their mission efforts, and they even adopted a system for classifying and communicating doctrine or teaching, one not at all dissimilar from the kind scientists use in the laboratory. In fact, a lot of the things that we in the Churches of Christ talked about could be outlined neatly in a series of steps as if that came right out of a lab. Hear, believe, repent, confess, be baptized. Those were the five steps to salvation. Singing, praying, preaching, communion, giving. Those were the five acts of worship. A brother named Jewel Miller produced a home Bible study course called the Visualized Bible Study Series. A very attractively packaged film strip series that you could set up a little projector and show it on the wall of almost any home. You would not be surprised to know that it was presented in five episodes. And it's important that you know I'm not criticizing those efforts of our recent ancestors. Thousands of people were taught and baptized and welcomed into church families using those methods for their time and place. Those ways of making disciples worked. But our times are different. For one, we no longer harbor unwavering confidence in science to solve all our problems. That's no offense to all you scientists out there. We've just seen so many times when it's reached its limits. Management techniques, which were very popular, particularly in the 70s and the 80s, didn't always translate well into church settings. And the truth is, we no longer trust our institutions to protect our interests anymore. We're no longer who we once were. When you went to the grocery store in 1960, everybody spoke the same language. They ate the same food. They shared the same values. Now you go to the grocery store, it's a cultural experience. There are as many different value systems from which to select in our culture as there are brands of peanut butter at Publix. People no longer grow up with a shared frame of reference. Teenagers are as likely to sit across the classroom aisle from a Buddhist as they are a Baptist. It's no longer advisable or even possible to apply the methods of engineering and management and science to the task of making disciples because we're not mass-producing identical products, and the truth is we probably never were. In some ways, America today is more like the Palestine Jesus lived in than the America of the last century. His culture was ethnically and religiously diverse. It was a battleground of competing value systems. He never practiced or prescribed a one-size-fits-all method for making or becoming a disciple, which is unfortunate. I mean, it would be neat if we could discover within the scriptures a workable system for mass producing disciples, kind of like Lucy in that when the chocolate started coming down the aisle, you know, we could say, hey, this is easy. We could just set up this assembly line and run people through on a spiritual conveyor belt and add the parts as they roll by. We could turn out disciples faster than Ford turns out cars. But making disciples, being disciples, is not like assembling a Mustang. Making or being a disciple is a relational art. You can't mass produce a Monet. You can't just assemble a poem. And you can't line sinners up at the baptistry and run them through like laundry. It takes time to make a disciple or to become one. Paul, the apostle, instructed his young apprentice Timothy, listen to this, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, which is an agricultural kind of way of thinking, right? Correct, rebuke, and encourage. And here's the thing, with great patience and careful instruction. Sometimes I think we get really frustrated with how slowly the Christian learning curve arcs across our lives and even the lives of others. Why am I still struggling to make prayer a regular discipline? How long before he learns to watch his mouth? When is she going to outgrow her arrogance? Will she ever learn to be content? When am I going to be able to stop struggling with lust? We get so tired of the slow progress in our own lives and in the lives of others. Maybe it would help to know that even Jesus sometimes grew exasperated with how long it can take to make a disciple. Luke chapter 9, verse 41, he once asked, "O unbelieving and perverse generation, how long shall I put up with you? How long shall I stay with you?" As it turns out, he took the time they needed, and he takes the time we need too. We're not bolting fenders onto Fords when we are making or being made into disciples. We are being recreated into the image of Christ by the Spirit of God. And have you looked around lately at what God has to work with? Have you looked in the mirror? I have, and gone, how are you going to make something out of this? It takes time. I have a friend in Atlanta who grew up in a place called Corner, Alabama. Does anybody here know where Corner, Alabama is? One, two people. Okay, it's that big. We were talking once, my friend and I, about how different the world we live in was from the worlds we grew up in, and how different living in the city was from living in the rural cultures into which we were born. And I'll never forget something that he said to me. He said, all of my people, his family, my people were all farmers who lived close to the land. They learned patience. Like, you know, Paul was saying, in season, out of season. He said, I live in a world of concrete and pavement, of express lanes, and of instant communication. My world is all about hurry. Their world was all about waiting. And then he said, I think my world is missing something important. What's that song right now, country music song, Automatic? Who does that? Miranda Lambert. Go home and Google Automatic. I should have played that for you. She talks about how everything used to move slowly and how everything now goes so fast. I think my friend and Miranda Lambert are right. Disciple making, disciple becoming demands enormous patience. If you're frustrated with yourself or somebody else, remember that it takes time. You want to change that metaphor just a little bit? Think about it, what it's like growing up. Okay? When you're a little child, you're this wobbly toddler. And then you grow into those awkward, hobbledy-hoy teenage years. That was the word for the teenagers. And then you become maybe a little more confident in your 20s, and then finally you flourish into a fully confident adult. You don't grow up physically quickly. You don't grow up spiritually quickly either. And it doesn't just take time, it requires a relationship between the disciple maker and the one being made into a disciple. You know the difference between an assembly line worker and an artist? The assembly line worker has a relationship with his tools. The artist has a relationship with her subject. See, the poet is not enamored of his pen or paper. He's captivated by the ideas in his mind and the words he's going to combine to create something that touches the heart. The painter isn't possessive of her canvas or of her palette or of her brushes. She's possessed by the image that's in her mind, and she's going to focus on that until she sees it reproduced in front of her. The assembly line worker works on his subject. The artist works with her subject. Which would you prefer, to be worked on or to be worked with? Making or becoming a disciple takes time because it requires relationship. Now, if you're looking for something practical this morning, try this. To be a disciple or to make disciples, you need two things: patience and proximity. You have to be there for a long, long time, and you have to stay close. If you expected the waters of baptism to somehow magically and immediately transform you into the image of Christ, I hope you hear some hope in this message. Don't get discouraged, and don't give up. Jesus is working with you not to create a Mercury, but to create a masterpiece. If you're wondering whether God can do anything with a life as confused and corrupted as yours, I hope you'll hear invitation. See, the church is not an assembly line using only precision-crafted parts to produce a million exact replicas. So don't worry about not fitting. This is more like a divine art studio where God, the master artist, uses whatever he has on hand to produce stunning originals. God can make something beautiful out of your life. And if you haven't seen any progress in a long, long time, I want you to hear some challenge. Maybe the reason you aren't growing into a clearer identity of Jesus isn't because you haven't found the right program or the right strategy or the right system or even the right church. Maybe it's because your relationship with God has drifted. Becoming like Christ is not going to happen quickly for anybody, and it won't happen at all unless we stay really, really close to Him. Let's take a couple of minutes here. Let's just be quiet, and then we'll sing.
Nearer, still nearer, close to thy heart, draw me, my Savior, so precious thou art. Fold me close to thee.
Jesus, my King. Only my sinful, now contrite heart, grant me the cleansing thy blood doth impart. Grant me the cleansing thy blood doth impart. Nearer still,
let's have a prayer together. God, we pray that last line we sang will be true. It'll be more than just words on the screen and words set to music, that sin in all of the lies that it tells us and that we tend to believe, that we really will resign from that and draw close to you. God, I pray that this week that we will find a way that is a part of who we are to draw closer to you. Maybe we'll read scripture a little more this week. We'll work harder to discipline ourselves to pray. Or that we'll connect with a class on Wednesday night or just find some way that we can draw closer to you, to find some quiet, to take a walk, just to be still, so that you and your Spirit can continue to work on us to make us more like Jesus, to work with us to make us more like Jesus. God, we love the beautiful things you create in people's lives, and we want that to be happening in us. So help us stay close, to take the time and stay close to you so that we can see that happen in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Next week, we're gonna start a new series called ID, Who We Really Are, from the book of Ephesians. So I mentioned to you several weeks ago to kind of read through Ephesians. It's not a long book at all. You can read through it in 30 minutes. Read through that. We'll begin next week. ID, who we really are in Jesus. See you then.
We are really, really glad that you were here this morning. And I hope that this has been meaningful. In fact, I want to come back and sing that last verse in just a minute when we finish those announcements, to kind of drive home what Jody was trying to say to us this morning about waiting and patience and being in proximity with God in this discipleship process that we're all in. But before we do that, these things as we close. Huntsville Inner City Learning Center is bringing actor-comedian Henry Cho to Willowbrook Baptist Church on March the 11th. It's a fundraiser. Cho's comedy is clean and can be enjoyed by the whole family. See your bulletin for ticketing information if you'd like to support HICLC. Baby shower for Lauren and Brandon Howard on Sunday, March the 6th, 1:30 to 3 in the Mercy Building. They're expecting twin girls and have registered at Amazon and Target. A night of worship, Saturday, February 27th at 7 in the Fellowship Hall downstairs. We're hosting Seek First His Kingdom. It's a night of worship, of teaching and praise. Eric Koyu and his Embracing Israel ministry is putting this together. And so if you'd like to get more about that, talk to Eric, or plan to be here on the 27th. That's this coming Saturday at 7. And Women's Ministry has a very important conference coming up, and they would like to show you a brief video about women's ministry, and then Ada Hanley is going to have a brief word about that upcoming event. So if you give your attention to this video.
Because your mom can teach you about Jesus, and then you can do the right thing. Because you really love him, you want to spend time with him. Because they can talk about Jesus together and have fun. Because you want to be their friend and be nice to them.
Because it's better to get lots of people than just yourself to talk about Jesus.
I don't always know what she's going through in life, and I don't know all the answers, and a lot of those women are wiser, and they, you know, can help her through.
These are the kind of people that help you grow spiritually and grow closer to God.
To form a real community where we can support each other and be there for each other in the hard times and in the great times.
That the joy that I feel this time in my life is something that I'd like to share with everybody, because I sure love the Lord.
We need to support one another, to mentor one another, and to learn from each other, because we all have different life experiences and we all need to learn.
I think as women, we have a tendency to search inward when we have problems with our faith, with our husbands, kids, jobs, whatever. And so we really need to team up together in this journey of life, just following Jesus and lifting each other up and being that 24-hour support system when we have issues and problems.
Hello, I'm Ada Handley, and Jody, I just want to thank you for this morning. That is our heart for women's ministry here, is that we are walking together and discipling each other. We have some amazing women in this church that I learn from on a daily basis, and even some of our teens that I learn from a lot. Our acronym for women's ministry is LIFT, which is Living in Faith Together. If we're not walking this road together, we're not going to grow, and we're not going to love our husbands as well or love our children as well either. So come join us. It's March the 12th from 8:30 until 12. Rika McCroy is amazing and has a lot of good things to share with us, and I just look forward to spending time with you. You can email me at ladies@twickenham.org if you would like to volunteer in any way, or if you have any questions. And there is a link to register at twickenham.org. Thank you.
Let's stand for that last verse and for our closing prayer.
Nearer, still nearer, while life shall last, till safe in glory, my anchor is cast. Through endless ages, ever to be, nearer my Savior, still nearer to thee.
Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we're thankful that we can be your children. You are the Father of grace, the Father of mercy, the Father that comforts us. Today, Father, there are many who are in need of your comfort. We especially ask that you be with the family of our brother Don Pryor. Also, we ask that you be with all those who are suffering, those who are in need of encouragement, those who are in need of your help to overcome whatever obstacles that may be in their path. Thank you, Lord, for the time that we have been here today, knowing that we are in your presence. We ask that you watch over those of our number who are traveling. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings and freedoms that we enjoy in our country. Thank you for Jesus, in whose name we offer this prayer. Amen.